Hi, today I'm coming to you with some LGBTQ book recommendations. I went through my book collection and basically picked some of my all-time favorites that have LGBTQ characters. A lot of them are own voices as well, and it's a collection of some books that I've read years and years ago that are all-time favorites, and then some that I've read more recently, and I think a few of them I haven't even talked about on here before, so I read them and haven't reviewed them yet, so I'm gonna try and put that all into this video. I'm going to start with graphic novels, and I've talked about this one before. It is The 100 Nights of Hero by Isabel Greenberg, who is by far my favorite graphic novelist. Is that what that's called? She is the author of the Encyclopedia of Early Earth. It's the story of Cherry and her maid Hero. Cherry is married, and one of her husband friends basically says, if you go away for a while, I bet I can seduce your wife. So the husband takes on the wager, and while every night this friend of her husband tries to seduce her, Hero, the maid that she's in love with, tells stories to distract him. So it's kind of based off Arabian Nights. And in this, you get to read the main story and then all the stories that she tells along the way. What I love about anything Isabel Greenberg does is that it has a lot of heart and it's very witty and quick. And let me show you some of the illustrations because they are so, so gorgeous. I'll just show you this page to give you a little example. I actually have one of the prints from our other books that I have up in my room. Oh yeah, the end papers are really, really gorgeous as well. And the other one is pretty much a staple whenever someone recommends LGBTQ books. And it is Fun Home, a Family Tragicomic by Ellison Bechdel. The same Bechdel who came up with the Bechdel test. It is about her family and her father who struggles with sexuality, and then about Ellison Bechdel herself and her realizing that she's gay. This is very much about how families work and maybe not fitting in with your family, keeping secrets from your family. She's done, I guess, kind of a sequel to this as well, which I haven't read yet. And I think the dedication is really interesting. For Mum, Christian, and John, we did have a lot of fun in spite of everything. I'm almost doing these in pairs. Next up, beautifully written YA. Next up, I've got Aristotle and Dante, Discover the Secrets of the Universe. I actually think this copy is Lena's. So Lena, if you're watching this, I'll return this to you soon. It's about two boys, Aristotle and Dante. They meet at the pool one summer. They start this friendship, then kind of have more feelings for each other. It follows them as they are together and separate. One of the two, I can't remember which one it is, has like quite a lot of anger issues as well. And then Ari has an older brother who's in prison. This was such a beautiful, I think in publishing they used the word gentle a lot, a gentle story. And I think this is kind of like genre-defining stuff. This is such an amazing YA book. And I think this one would also make for a really, really good gift for someone. The next book had kind of a similar atmosphere, and it is We Are Okay by Nina LaCour. This is the story of Marin and Mabel. It takes place in empty university dorms over the winter break, and it delves into Marin's history, and the more you read, the more you kind of figure out her backstory. I feel like it really covers how she is trying to get to terms with love and emotions and relationships and family on a bunch of different levels. This is working out very well. Next up, dystopian. This book I read when I just started working at Hotkey. It's called Maggot Moon by Sally Gardner, and I thought this book was really, really special. Sally Gardner has dyslexia, and she wanted to write a book that people with dyslexia can read as well, and the chapters on this are really, really short. Sometimes it's one or two pages, but I always want to say that what some authors can do with a paragraph, Sally Gardner can do with four or five words. In this book, you kind of get to see what it's like to live under a regime. People in this book are constantly under surveillance. They're being monitored by the motherland. There is a moon landing that is happening. And Standish, the main character, discovers something and feels like he has to make a stand. There's some quite gruesome scenes in here, but it's a really, really beautifully written book, and I actually would love to read it again. And then another dystopian one. This is The Big Lie by Julie Mayhew. Now, this is one that when I heard the pitch, I just knew it was my kind of book. I've talked about this book loads and loads. It's about a girl called Jessica Keller, and she lives in a world that is kind of like an alternative history slash future where Germany has won the Second World War and has taken over a lot of countries, including England. It's set in England, and it almost feels like it's set in maybe North Korea. Jessica is basically a good girl. Her family is a good family. She does everything she needs to do. And then a family moves in on the same street, and the daughter, Clementine, is a rebel. Clem and Jessica fall in love, but there's this constant struggle between wanting to do what her parents tell her to do or fighting against the regime. And because it's like a really extreme and dystopian setting, again, there's like quite a few upsetting scenes in here as well. This book made a really, really big impression on me, and I think it might also give a view of, I guess, what is still happening in certain countries. Quick poetry break. This is Don't Call Us Dead by Denez Smith. This poetry bundle is incredible. I read this because of work and then I'm just refusing to let go of it. It deals with themes like police brutality, AIDS, racism. I would definitely recommend looking up some videos as well of performances of these poems. This is not the book I want to talk about, but it's one I want to read. But I don't have the other book that I wanted to talk about, which is The Accident Season by the same author, Maura Fowley Doyle. She's written a great blog post where she talks about how she just wants to have more bisexual characters in books. And so a bunch of the characters in her books are bisexual. She just kind of says, you know, deal with it. That's what I want to write. The Accident Season is really fun and quite dark. A great Halloween read. I think I've talked about it in a Halloween Reads video. It's about a girl who has another girl from school that keeps showing up in her pictures. But then when she tries to sort of follow down the track of where this girl is coming from, no one really seems to know where that girl is or who they're talking about. And it's about a family that every year they have this time period where they keep having accidents, and it's trying to figure out whether that's real or not, whether it's magic or not. And then the magical theme returns in the Spellbook of the Lost and Found, but I haven't actually read that yet. Then there is Release by Patrick Ness. This book was really fun and kind of weird, and I hosted a book club for it. The main character is Adam. It's also kind of shaped after Mrs. Dalloway, so it's all set in one day. There's something supernatural happening. This was 100% not what I expected it to be, but it was such a good surprise. And I think I remember like the main character talking quite frankly about like having sex with another guy. And I loved hearing Patrick Ness talk about the things that he wishes he could have read when he was younger. And then of course, how could I miss out The Miseducation of Cameron Post? I've talked about this book a lot, so I'm not gonna talk about it for very long, but I don't know if you've seen the film. I loved the film. They kind of take the second half of this book, but this is about a girl growing up in, I keep getting it wrong, Montana. When her parents pass away when she's young, she figures out she's into girls, and when her aunt does find out, she sends her to conversion therapy camp. Recently watched a video by the author, and again, just hearing her talk about how she wanted to write what was her reality. So I think it's set in the 90s, maybe. What I loved about this as well, which unfortunately is not really in the film, is that Cameron kind of has this other female character that talks to her about gay pride and all these things that Cameron hasn't really heard about because she doesn't have access to anything apart from like the DVDs she can get a hold of. And I also love the beginnings of relationships that are in here. It feels very summery and like the first flutters of love, even though it also covers like some really, really heavy topics. So, all right, last two. This is a well-loved and read copy. This is Clerial by Garth Nix, fantasy. This is part of the Old Kingdom series, which is one of my favorite series of all time. Clerial, the character in this, is asexual. It's not really a main point in the book, but it does come up, especially in the beginning, a few times where she talks about how she's had experiences with people and she figured out for herself that that is not something she's interested in. Haven't found that many books yet that have asexual characters in them, so I'd be interested to read more. It was quite, I guess, like a nice surprise to come across it in this book. If you love fantasy, this is so amazing. And what I love here as well is that she has to go to a finishing school. I love anything that kind of has like a school setting. I always just kind of want to reread the bits of Harry Potter where they're just at school doing homework. Finally, another classic, Oranges Are Not the Only Fruit by Jeanette Winterson. I had heard many, many people talk about it, but I still didn't have a very good idea of what it was about. And when I read it, it's so funny. It's so out there. It is the story of Jeanette. I can't remember if it was in the introduction or in an interview where she talks about, you know, the main character is called Jeanette, but why would it be about me? But then it also, when you read about her life, seems to have quite a lot of overlap. Yeah, so she uses herself as a fictional character. So this is about a girl who's adopted into a quite strict religious family, and basically she's being raised to become a missionary. Then she figures out that she's gay, has to hide it. When you read this, there's a lot of things that she sort of thought were normal when she was growing up, and then when you read it yourself or you see outside of it, you can tell that it's definitely different. I must have said this before, one of my favorite bits is when the mom is like holding a glass to the wall to hear if the neighbors are fornicating on a Sunday. I just feel like this is one of a kind. I would definitely recommend it, as I do with all the books in this video. All right, I hope that was a good selection. There were definitely quite a few. Obviously, I'm always looking for more LGBTQ books because, to be fair, there's not enough out there. As you might have noticed, there weren't any books in here that have trans characters, so if you have any recommendations for that specifically, I would love to hear about that too, and I will definitely be doing a sequel to this in the future. I'm also gonna link some videos by other BookTubers recommending LGBTQ reads. All right, thank you so much for watching. Doei!